people, challenges, developing, well, development, and gaming, which would be a bit odd if that wasn't there. But next slide. Right, this is our executive team for 2023, as you see. My name is Tosal, my friends call me Noah. I am the president of GDG. We have Zane, our vice president. Zane, where are you?
Oh, they're out doing stuff.
They're gone, they have left me. That's okay.
They're doing chores.
Right, we have Josh, our treasurer, who is also with Zane. We have Eddie, our tutorials officer, who is also with Zane. We have Zach, our events manager, who also does Kimi Jam, for anyone that actually knows what Kimi Jam is. It's like a massive game jam. We have Daz, our arts coordinator, Orion, who is a general exec. Jordan, who is also general exec, and Clinton on OBS, who is also a general executive. That's the executive team for 2023, basically. Right, next slide. Okay, so as you guys know, game development is made up of a lot of different disciplines. These are the five main ones. For me, we have music, we have writing. We don't really have dedicated musicians or writers that you could at least look to for guidance, but you know, we would love it if you were, and you were to help. For art, we have Addy and Daz. For code, you have me and Zane, and also Clinton and Josh, as we are all programmers. And design, you have Jordan, who is somewhere. Awesome. So if you guys are sharing if you guys like want some guidance or you want to know something a bit more about this and you feel a little bit out of your depth maybe, feel free to ask one of us or just start a conversation with any of us. All right, cool. Now, I know we did say at Clubs Expo that we do tutorials. We do in fact do tutorials. There are two different scene tutorials. We have Eddie's pixel art tutorials where he will teach you lines, shapes, colors, palettes, and more. All that jazz. So for anyone like that, he runs the pixel art tutorials. Then there's me, Noah. I run the coding / Unity tutorials. My ones cover C Sharp and Unity, as it says there. Cool. All right. Quick slide. Okay, cool. For anyone that wants to join council, we do have a few open positions. We have a secretary which handles things like the meeting minutes and keeping us all in check for the meeting. We have our marketing manager who basically is in charge of furthering the cause of GDG, basically getting us more out there, giving us more exposure, things like that. Social media manager, if you want to manage our socials like our Insta, our Discord, our proper socials. Coordinators, this is actually a new role. So if you feel like you have some expertise in a certain field, like one of the five that we mentioned previously, you could become a coordinator in that specific area. And the role of coordinator is kind of you're an authority or a semi-authority on your given role, and you would perhaps help make tutorials for future tutorials. And if none of that appeals to you, we also have general exec, which is a lot more laid back and basically just helping around with general stuff in the club. So if you are interested in any of those roles, paying anyone in council, get in touch with one of us and we will sit that out. Alright, now for our guest speaker, who is not currently here.
Oh wait.
Yeah, he's running a bit late. That happens in game dev, you get caught in traffic and stuff like that. He will be here soon.
He's there.
He's there? Oh. Okay. I'm so sorry, I did not see you there at all.
That's right, I snuck around.
You look wonderful. Right, there's Adam. And everyone please give a warm round of applause for Adam Dong.
Just stand up.
I'll just put this here.
You want to sit here? Or,
how would I go to the next slide?
Yes.
Oh yeah, you use the mouse and just scroll up and down.
I just put this here.
Use this.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Right.
Mobile unit.
Feed with reverence.
Oh, yeah.
Cool. Hello, everybody. How's everyone doing? Is this a mic or?
Yeah. It'll pick you up.
Can you guys hear me in the back? Yeah?
Yep, that's good.
That's not really a mobile mic, so.
All good.
Okay.
I'll just project. Yeah. How's everyone doing? So I'm told you're all students here. It's nice to meet you all. My name is Adam Thompson. So many screens here. Yeah, and I'm a game developer, but I also have a particular affinity and investment into self-development, and that's actually the main topic of this talk today. My thesis is that if you want to excel at game development, or pretty much any profession out there, notice that I've keyed the word professional, it's not necessarily game development, but any kind of profession, then I think a lot of what I'm going to discuss here today is going to be very important. So, peace be upon you all. If anybody doesn't know, this is Arabic. It means assalamu alaikum, translates to peace be upon you all. I'm part Arabic, so I like to greet people with that. I think it's a very nice greeting. And I'm Thompson, hello. I have this big AI craze right now. It's pretty much the year, and I think the next decade, or probably two. So this image was, I gave it like 20 photos of me, and it like made me handsome. There's an app called Lenser, if anybody cares. But anyway, I'm Adam Thompson. My day job, as in my 9-to-5, I have a remote working job for Synty Studios. If anybody doesn't know, Synty is the top asset providers for Unity. And I'm a user experience researcher and product designer there. I also have my own studio called Emotion Theory, and I'll talk about that later. So I'm the founder of that. I kind of juggle these two things together. And as I said at the start, mainly who I am as a person, I would say that my areas are game development and self-development. I think the two go hand in hand. I think self-development kind of goes hand in hand with anything, but I'm going to talk from the context of game development and how self-development kind of enhances the experience that.
So, I'll actually go to this link in my website.
All right, sure. I'll handle it.
Yeah, thank you. And just go to the About page. I just want to briefly talk about my history. And the reason for that is I think it's important to kind of set a bit of context so that you know where I'm coming from. Why do I care so much about self-development, for example? Like, isn't it enough for me to have had a game development experience and just kind of talk about that? Well, I'll say that since 2011, maybe just scroll down a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Since 2011, I have been working in games, and I've had a pretty interesting, and I would say I'm very grateful for the experience that I've had. And over that 10, 12 years, it's been now. There's a lot that I've learned. I'm currently right here. This is in reverse chronological way, but I'm now working at Synty Studios. But you just kind of scroll. I worked in virtual reality, I've worked in education, I've worked on a Kickstarter project, I've worked for Steam, a lot of MMO games, a lot of contracts. I was also a lecturer for two different universities, actually not this one, so I won't name their names. I've really dabbled and enjoyed game design, and that was kind of my main area. My background is also in computer science, so I started out as a front-end developer. And I've taken particular delight in some of the theory that comes with games exploration. I think the reason I'm so fascinated with video games as a whole is that I find it a medium that is so, so powerful. It's really powerful in terms of how you can share ideas, how you can explore those ideas in an interactive form. And I think particularly those in game development, we have the job and the duty to explore this medium to impact the world, basically. Even if it's just about stuff that's fun and like creating memories, I think in the end it's all really impactful, and we should look at it with the kind of respect that it deserves. Our games and our products go out to other people, and ultimately we are impacting the world whether we care to believe it or not. So,
yeah, feel free to like use the mouse to scroll down.
Thank you. No. If you could go back, I think that's all I need for now. Right. The slides should be good for now. So,
all right, yep, just click.
So this is my story. I like this picture. Does anybody know what game that is?
Final Fantasy X.
Yeah, all right. So it kind of begins with, well, not this game in particular, but the industry, the series as a whole. It actually began. Watch the whole thing, but something really interesting about this. This is the intro cutscene to the 1997 version of Final Fantasy VII on PlayStation 1. And he starts the drawing for a comfortably long time. Let's look at the time now. 39 seconds. I'm staring at stuff. 40 seconds. It's still going.
I'll just end it there. Well, for dramatic effect, we'll turn the lights off, we'll like turn the volume down, like everything. But the point of me sharing that with you is that if you can just imagine, because I know a lot of you, there's a generation gap that I don't want to work here. I'm basically an old man now. And it's hard to kind of see myself in that way. But I was 7 years old when this game came out. And what we just saw here was just absolutely utterly mind-blowing. I'm trying to think of a modern-day equivalent that was just like absolutely blowing my mind. I don't even think like the latest cutting-edge game is as impactful as this was back in 1997. Like when we look at the new Sony like first-party game, it's like, yeah, it looks pretty cool. I'll probably buy that day one. But I don't think it has the same impact as like, wow, this changes everything. Wow, this is like so immersive. There's nothing like this that has ever been seen before. I don't think there's something quite like that today. But you have to know in 1997, we literally went from Mario jumping in 2D to the 3D era, where full motion video was common, a staple. Like 3D worlds started to become the way you explored games. It was a massive leap forward in technology. And the reason I go left to share this personal story with you, of me playing this, is because I want you to understand something very, very profound as context for what's to come. I have an enormous love and affection, and I'd say even an allegiance to video games and to game development and to the power that this medium holds. So when I go to say some of the stuff that I'm about to say, it may seem like I'm contradicting myself. I want you to know that I have, as I said, an enormous connection to this. So just know that. I was 7 or 8 years old when this game came out, and the games I was into at the time were like Spyro the Dragon and Crash Bandicoot. So this was very different. It felt mature and just deeper and more meaningful than those games did back then. So I feel like I was growing up alongside this game.
Sorry.
Oh, there we go. Oh, could you just go back one? So the...
Yeah, just use the mouse, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm gonna keep it on here for a bit. The cover art of this game is just a white cover with the logo on it. So again, compared to say like Crash Bandicoot or Spyro the Dragon, these are very colorful games. The marketing material is super apparent on the covers. So when you go to the shop as a kid and you're looking at all these covers, these colors are trying to get your attention. So this game, to have such an intense commitment to minimalism, like this is the main menu, it's just a picture with two options. It felt different. And again, as a kid, it felt like this moment when I'm holding this thing, you know, like when Harry Potter, it's like he's a wizard and the wind like blows in his face. It kind of felt like that moment. So anyway, I knew I wanted to become a game developer. Whatever it took to go down that path, I mean, like I'm fast forwarding ahead, but I went and I studied computer science, which is basically programming, which is how you make games. And then I joined to my first job and I went into design and etc. And here we are today. That's a quick fast forward of where we are. Over the last, throughout my career, the last 10 or 10 plus years, the thing that I started to learn very quickly though was that my connection to games, it was very personal. If ever there was some kind of doubt from someone else that maybe I should be doing something else for my career, I was very defensive about it. I felt very deeply connected to games as a storytelling medium, as a powerful interactive medium. I knew since I was a kid this is what I wanted to do. So whenever that came into question, and it wasn't always just the whispers of other people, but it was my own experience telling me that what it is that I'm looking for in life isn't always necessarily found here. And what that meant for me was that I was stuck. Like, where would it be if not here? This is all that I knew in order to find meaning. Like, my purpose in life was to produce games to impact people. If that's not the way to do it, then I'd need to start from scratch again and find what the meaning of life is. So that kind of brings me to the topic here. The title of this talk is How to Be a Healthier,
happier, more productive game dev professional, and whether it's game dev or any other kind of profession, I think the other keywords are very important here. Health, happiness, productivity, and carrying ourselves with professionalism. I think no matter what you do in life, if you are able to maintain your health, and of course I'm talking about both mental and physical health, if you can be happy with the relationships you have and what you do every day, if you can be productive in exercising your mastery and delivering and utilizing and leveraging your skills to deliver value, then that's the way to go. That's how you can succeed in any industry and ultimately in life. Because when you ask yourselves why you're here and why you've chosen to study what you're studying and why you choose to do what you want to do, there are layers of questions there, of purpose. And we'll get into that in the next few slides. But that's my history. That's kind of a bit of context as to why I started to shift my focus a little bit less solely on game development, but also just on well-being and mindfulness. And we're going to kind of do a quick rundown of that in this. Again, this is from the context of me as a game developer. So the next slides, I've got like 30 or 40, there's plenty of them. I'm going to go through each one really quickly. Know that this is a deeply comprehensive, overarching subject. And each slide in isolation could be its own blog post, video essay, something or other, like a research topic. Each one could have its own depth. And I'm not exploring the depths here, unfortunately, just for time, but do forgive the pace at which I go through this. But in the end, I'm gonna give some action steps to kind of bring it all together, and hopefully some tangible things that you guys can do to like live your best lives. So these are not really categorized. I would have liked to categorize them like mind, body, soul, relationships, money, mastery, and impact. Those are the seven categories that I like to categorize things in, but they're kind of a little all over the place, so do forgive the chaos. Maybe we can leave some space in the Q&A and maybe we can talk after to kind of bring a bit more context to it. But anyhow, let's go. How am I for time? How much time do I have?
You're good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
First one, and these are kind of like 1, 2, 3, 4, like I'm just going to treat each one as like a bullet point numbered one. Commit to yourself. What that means is, when in relationships, often we ask the other to commit to us. Now, I'm not going to really comment on relationships, I'm not a relationship guru, but we all have a relationship with ourselves, and when I say commit to yourself, I say more so than anything else, your career, or your parents, or your family, or your siblings, or your actual relationship. It is most important to commit firstly to yourself. The example I'm going to give is that when you go on an airplane, they always tell you this in the safety videos, to first put on your oxygen mask before you tend to your child or to the person that needs you. The reason is, if you're not there, you can't help other people. It's the same wisdom here. If you do not take care of yourself, you absolutely cannot do your job, you cannot take care of other people, you can't go on to live your best lives. And that's what we want here. Commit to yourself. Aspire for balance. These are the seven buckets, as I call them, that I mentioned before. And I'm just going to cite a scientist. His name is Abraham Maslow. If anybody has studied science or psychology before, he is most famous for something called Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Essentially, it's a picture of a pyramid saying that, first of all, you check. Are you being chased by a lion? Is your life in danger? No? Assuming your life is not in danger, it's fine. You can breathe. You need to then breathe. Your next quest, I suppose, is to make sure you have enough food, enough water. Make sure that you're alive. So you kind of climb up this hierarchy. Now, assuming you're not in danger, everything's fine, you've got air in your lungs, you've got food in your belly, like you're alive. Now what? What do we do now? We seek safety, we seek shelter, we seek relationships. Again, it kind of goes up. And the thing at the very top is something called, what's it called?
Self-actualization.
Thank you. Yes, self-actualization, which is basically like finding purpose in life. So again, in terms of balance, any one of these buckets that are emptied, think of it like a survival game, right? Like when your hunger gauge goes down, you need to get food. And then if your health goes down, you need to increase your health, etc. It's kind of like the same thing. You need to make sure these buckets are kind of all level. If all the other buckets are full and only one bucket is depleted, it's still going to impact your well-being. It's not enough to invest in just one bucket or even six out of the seven. And by the way, these are arbitrary buckets that I've chosen. I think you all need to find the buckets that you want to invest in and make sure that they're kind of all topped up at all times. Find your purpose. I want to remind you all that this talk, like, and these points, they're all in the context of being healthy, happy, and productive. So I'm talking in the context of being productive and being excellent at your job. When I say find your purpose, especially this idea of layers of purpose, I'll explain that. If you have a task, like your boss has told you what to do, your quest, and I like to use game terminology here, and analogies, but your current quest at that moment is to do the task that your boss set you to do. Maybe it's some programming task. But the layer of purpose above that is why you are doing the programming task. If you have a job in a game studio, well, it's obviously to create some kind of game. Well, that's maybe like a few layers above. Your task above, your purpose above the current task is to fulfill the current sprint that you have. Sprint is just like a period of time where you're trying to achieve certain things. So you're kind of thinking in terms of these layers. And even when you're given a task, you break it down even further. Like, how can this task be broken down into subtasks? The point I'm trying to make here is be conscious and aware of all the layers. And I'm talking about the layer above as high as you can go. Why am I doing this thing? Because my boss told me to. Why did my boss tell me to? Because I have this job. Why do I have this job? We're making this game. Why do we care about this game? Well, it's a job that makes me money. Why do I need money? Because I need to pay rent. It's annoying, but it's called the Socratic method in philosophy. Socrates is the person who annoyingly kept asking why. I implore you all to keep asking why. Why your purpose is for each level, and go as high as you can. What's the meaning of life? Yeah, that's how high I want you to go. The thing is, if you know the purpose above the task that you're currently on, it empowers you to do the task. Does that make sense? Like, when you find a task difficult, and when you find, like, why am I even doing this thing? When you understand the purpose above that, and the one above that, and the one above that, it gives you context as to why you're doing it. It will fuel and empower you to get it done. And we're all about being effective here. Okay, this one is about self-care. Fix your environment. There's something I like to do whenever I'm in a jam. It's called Project Field. If ever I wake up and I can't be bothered to get out of bed and I'm questioning life and I'm just feeling particularly down, we all have those days, what I like to do is say, all right, what can I do to fix this? And rather than problem solve it each time, I basically have like a go-to project. It's called Project Feel Good. Basically, it's like, boom, I'm going to do these things and I'm going to feel good. The first one, and everybody needs to kind of like make your own tasks for this request of yours. But for me, for example, it would be like to clean my house. It would be to take a shower. It would probably be to like, well, I might go running or do some exercise and then take a shower. I might eat some food. I might drink some water. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you're feeling depressed, you have to think, again, think of the hierarchy of needs. Well, am I hungry? Am I thirsty? Like, do I have my needs met? Start thinking about that and start serving your own self. Do not sit in a position where it's just you deteriorating. Make that your quest.
By the way, you have 10 more minutes.
10 more minutes, boom, we're gonna go through it, no problem. Fix your social media diet, okay? Every time you go on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, God, I hope you don't use TikTok. But yeah, every time you go on any of these apps, your homepage is algorithmically produced. What that means is everything you interact with, and most importantly, who you subscribe to, is going to populate your feed. if all you see is like gaming videos and you click one and another and another and another and suggested videos and the comments and you go down this rabbit hole, there's hours of your life. And if you do a little bit of introspection, you will probably find that spending time on these social platforms is not increasing your well-being. So if you're going to find yourself on these platforms anyway, the best chance you have is to fix what you see on the homepage, and you can do that by unfollowing everything that doesn't serve you and make you feel good, and start following stuff that makes you feel good. So if you start going on YouTube and what you see is like healthy diet videos, recipe videos, and like good well-being content. There's a particular guy, like his name is Infinite Waters. He does like well-being content. He's so like crazy, but he's like really funny. And every time I see a video of his, if I'm procrastinating and I click on it, at least I come out after watching that video feeling a little bit better. Fix your social media diet. Better yet, get off social media. But that's the kind of intermediate step. Plan your day. That's an obvious one. I won't get into that. But plan every day. There's a quote, you either fail to plan. Wait, if you fail to plan, then you plan to fail. Make a routine and stick to it. It sounds boring. We like the idea that any day, anything can happen. We can just wake up whenever we like. But it directly contributes to our deteriorating well-being. If you have a routine and you stick to it, you will find that, again, just like a video game, like your grinds will go up eventually. And you'll make gains in that area, in that regard. So do that. Spend some time deciding what is a routine that I could see myself doing. That if I stuck to that for 3 months, if all I did is that, what would I look like in 3 months? Like literally meditate, close your eyes and visualize what you would look like in 3 months if you went to the gym 3 times a day, if you went walking 10,000 steps every day, 7 days a week, if you started eating clean, if you woke up at the same time every day, meaning that your sleep routine is excellent, all these things factor into your mental health. Gosh, you'd all be like super people in 3 months. Stack good habits, whatever, self-explanatory. This one I will explain a little bit. Reflect daily. As part of your routine, I would deeply encourage that you have, that you allocate a period of time every day to reflect. What I mean by reflection, and we do this in the game industry as well, we call it post-mortems. Every sprint, a sprint being about a period of say 2 weeks, where we have work allocated and everybody goes to do it, we have these reflections, what went right and what went wrong. And those reflections are so deeply important for us to operate effectively as a team in game development. So it's the same with your life. You should be reflecting on what's working and what isn't. And you should be doing that daily. And it shouldn't take too much time, but give yourself the time to do that. This is kind of the same thing. Dedicate time for self-improvement. What I do is I have about 20 minutes a day where I reflect and I think, how can I improve my life? Like, I literally think about it. Because the thing is, the truth is, all of these slides here, and anything that I could share with you, and any life coach even out there that would share all of these pearls of wisdom with you, the truth is, you already know. You already know all of this. You really just need to do it. The only way you're going to do it is if you actually give yourself the time to think about it and think of how you can incorporate it into your day. Everybody has a bespoke and unique day and life. Nobody can really like implement this for you, so this is the task that I prescribe for you to do to implement this. Fix your diet, that's an obvious one. There's so much science to suggest that your mental health and well-being is so directly correlated to your physical health and well-being. It's an absolute given, therefore, to make sure that you're eating the right food and to exercise your body, which is another separate point. That's an obvious one. Drink water. If you're dehydrated, you get headaches. If you're a billionaire with a headache, you're living a terrible life. Think about that. That's awful. Drink some water. It's that simple. Sunlight and vitamin D. Vitamin D is one of the like top deficiencies that people have in the world, like teenagers and young adults. It's an easy remedy. Go outside. And I know people like to joke about touching grass, but I mean, hey, you should do that.
How am I doing for time, sorry?
5 more minutes. Cool.
5 more minutes.
Can you see like the slide count?
Oh, no, I have.
Never mind. I'll just like
boom, 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 path to it. We'll go up 10,000 steps. There's so much evidence to suggest that our bodies are basically like cars, and as we move them, we're using our fuel. Using our fuel means that we're burning calories, and it's how you can maintain your body. If you're not burning more calories than you're consuming, then you're getting heavier. And if you're getting heavier, you're getting more depressed. And if you're getting more depressed, you will not be effective. Everything's connected. Stay in touch with people. Relationships are the most important thing in life, I would say. And at the end of the day, again, that millionaire or billionaire with a headache and who's alone, he's not a happy person. There you go. Prioritize relationships. In the end, everything we do is about humans and relationships. Go minimal. The more that you have, the more depressed and anxious you get. It's counterproductive. We feel that the more we attain, the more validation and the more, basically the more that we have. We can only feel better by having more, but it's in fact the opposite. It's not quite inversely proportional, but it's something like that. It's actually more like a bell curve. If you have absolutely nothing, you're depressed too. It sucks to be poor. If you have enough, you're probably at your peak. But then if you have an excess, you're back down to the plus. I wish I had a bell curve, but you guys can visualize that. Marie Kondo is a very famous Japanese-American woman, famous for this quote of hers, "Does it spark joy?" Basically, it's the litmus test for whether you should keep something or pass it on. So that's how you can, that's a practical way you can stay minimal, is to ask, does this object that I own, does it either spark joy, or the previous slide, it said it's either beautiful or it's useful to you. This is kind of like a test you can use to decide whether you keep something or let it go. Delayed gratification versus instant gratification. I don't have much time to get into these, but basically, the more instant gratification we give ourselves, junk food, pornography, video games, movie night, Netflix, etc., the more we're actually destroying our dopamine receptors in our brain. It's important for us to therefore do a dopamine detox. So try and spend a bit more time away from your computer and your phone. You should try and routinely do this. In order to get better sleep, okay, I was hoping the next slide was about sleep, but to get better sleep, a little life hack is to not use the computer or phones or anything like that for the last hour that you're awake. Blue light affects your sleep affects your well-being, etc. Like I said, it's all connected. Cut the excess, what doesn't serve you, ditch it. Right, I mean, that's an obvious one. If it does not serve you, let it go. Relationships, toxic people, things that you own, practices that you do. Like, if you find yourself playing League of Legends every night for 3 hours, and you take stock of your well-being, you're like, well, actually, I just kind of automatically go to my computer and do this anyway. Why? Is this actually what I want to do? Is this what I think is actually a good life? I mean, it might be, and I don't mean to be judgmental here, but the idea is to ask yourself. Ask yourself. Don't operate on autopilot. Practice discipline. I'm just going to power through these because I don't think I have too much time, but I'll explain at the end how I'll make these slides available to you and how each one can be elaborated upon and some resources that I'll pass on your way as well. But yeah, think of the rest of what's to come as just sort of like little tools in your tool bag that you can employ. And then we'll get to some action steps. People who embrace discomfort are stronger people, more capable people, and are more happier people ultimately. I've commented on that already, but again, I did preface by saying some things will sound a little counterintuitive. As somebody who has an enormous love, affection, and allegiance to games, 12 years in the industry, I've played like every new game that comes out. I'm a game designer, so I'm one of those guys who I play for research. I'm that guy, and I'm telling you, we need to spend less time gaming. If Marie Kondo said tidying up is life-changing magic, then I am saying journaling is life-changing magic. you can find your purpose, you can find well-being. It really is like having a free therapist. You should absolutely journal each day, and I encourage you to employ that into your routine. We all know about meditation. It's not a secret. It's not like, oh, what is that? We know what it is. We also know that going to the gym will increase your body. These are not unique, special, like, secrets. They're kind of open secrets. It's just we don't really do them. Time?
Speed run.
Hey, one of my slides is speed run, so that's pretty cool. Be kind, self-explanatory, but kind people are happy people. Hurt people. Think about that. Sharpen your tools. There's a quote. Maybe you can read that later. Get enough sleep, I already said that. Be authentic, beautiful. It's kind of cheesy, but it makes sense. This is great when job hunting too. Don't be one of those people that kind of like fakes it. Be authentic and seek what you actually enjoy. Get organized, digitize your documents, use Google Docs or Notion. Notion's better than Google Docs. I use this app called Dailyo. Life changing. You should get it. Surround yourself with good people because you are the average of the five people you spend most of your time with. If you're hanging out with a bunch of druggies, you're going to be a druggie. Hang out with five awesome people, and even if they're like above you, you will just like naturally rise to that level. It's another life hack. Be part of communities. As human beings, we ought to be connected. It's so ingrained in us. Your vibe attracts your tribe. So think about the kind of people you want to attract in your life, about the people that are close to you that you want to kind of be more like. And then you can aspire to be more like them, kind of preemptively. Gamify your life. Life is like Persona, the game Persona. If anyone's played it, you've got your stats, you've got your social links, you got your day-to-day. Don't do it in the game, do it in life. Educate yourself. Read this book. I'll have a list of like a bunch of books you could read. Seek help, of course. I'm talking about like ways you can tangibly increase your well-being, but there are some genuine issues like trauma, anxiety, PTSD, which requires professional help. Do seek them if you need to. Practice affirmations, use a mirror, tell yourself you're awesome. That's another book. It's good. Be like Bruce Lee. Adapt what is useful, reject what is useless, and add what is specifically your own. Amazing quote, amazing guy. AAA games and R&D. You should copy AAA games, basically. Because they spend a lot of time solving problems that you don't need to solve, because you don't have time and money like they do. Use AI. Speedrun your own work, there you go. To become better, just speedrun your own stuff. Become your biggest cheerleader. Okay, action steps. For mental health, there's this free year course. It's called The Science of Wellbeing. I'll provide a link afterwards, but you should all do this. It's excellent and it's free. Get your mental health score. I know that's cheesy, depression.org.nz, but seriously, in your own time, go there. If you are concerned with how you score on your mental health, then do this. Because again, if you have a metric, you can gamify it. You can get a better score. You can think of ways to optimize that. I don't mean to like trivialize this whole thing. Like again, if you have serious issues, you should seek professional help. But if these are things that you feel capable of doing and changing, then I absolutely encourage it. Set your goals, craft a routine, invest in yourself, you know, get a good like keyboard and mouse and stuff. You're on the computer most of the time, so may as well have those things be top notch. Do a weekly reflection, as I said before. Start slow and small. My first health routine was to just get 10,000 steps a day. Then I improved from that. Once that was easily, like once I knocked that out, I was like, man, I want more quests on my daily routine, you know? And just live your best life. I mean, that's what it's all about.
TikTok addiction, but no promises.
Oh, wow, there you go.
Wow.
So this QR code just goes to emotiontheory.com. There's a place where you can put, there's a link to a Discord invite, as I said before, if you wish to be part of a Discord community. And the slides, I will put them up there too, if you put your email in the thing. Boom, I'll send it to you. And a bunch of other insights, as well as a list of resources. So everything that you saw here, elaborated and expanded upon. Please do that.
I have a question.
That's already
done. I want the first one. Okay, great. Sorry. First question I would like to ask is, so you are a comp-sci grad from UA, right?
I am, yeah, from here. I just graduated from here so long ago.
What tips could you give to people that perhaps want to enter the game industry and they're at university, but they don't really know what specific steps to take to give them?
This is an amazing question. First of all, can I get a show of hands? Who's studying computer science here? Awesome, most of you. So I studied computer science here as well. And I just assumed that you don't study computer science and graduate and get a job in games. I assumed, wrongfully, that you kind of have to like work your way up. The truth is it was wrong back in 2011, but it's like super wrong today too, because the games industry has grown so much. There's an abundance of jobs here. And we live in a new post-pandemic reality. Remote work is such a thing. So even if there aren't jobs in Auckland, you could be staying in Auckland working from other places. So advice is to, first of all, know that, because I didn't know that. I actually went to study game development, or I was thinking of studying game development at one of these like specialized institutions. Mm. Terrible idea. Get a job. They will pay you to learn game development rather than you pay an institution to learn game development after 3 years. So know that there are jobs out there. They do want computer science graduates and people in between. And take your shots, man. Start applying. You can look for work on LinkedIn. Back in the day, I used seek.co.nz. I don't know if that's still around. Anyway, but I think LinkedIn would be the best bet, and making connections would be your best bet, which is why you should find me on LinkedIn.
So with your job, you're saying that you're working for a company that makes assets for Unity?
That's right. Let me pull it up real quick.
Syntystore.com.
Yeah.
So what's your job like?
So my job, first of all, these guys are 3D artists and they make 3D graphics. But I'm a game designer, a game developer. I don't really fit into that. They're actually doing stuff additional to that. It's kind of like new secret stuff, right? Can't really talk about it, but yeah, they're expanding beyond just artists. And so my job there firstly was a user interface developer, but now I'm a UX researcher and product designer. So even an art studio like that have a place for technical people, and you find jobs everywhere. That's really it. Yeah. Did you have a specific question about that?
It was more about what kind of products you've made in the past. Like, what's your work been like?
Yeah, awesome. Could you go to syntystore.com and then you tap? So that's my day job. And then I also have, and this is the best thing about being a developer, I also have assets on the Unity store myself. When I say assets, I don't mean like 3D graphics necessarily, which is what these guys do, but I have code assets on them. I have Unity extensions and plugins and tools and code solutions. I've written more user interface components, and these are available for sale on the asset store. If you actually go to unityassetstore.com, I think, or just Google Unity Asset Store, and you search my name, Emotion Theory, you'll find my work on the asset store. So that's a place where you guys could go. I would say that between now and you finding jobs, you should either be making a game of your own using Unity or Unreal or Godot or whatever. I don't really talk about that much, but if anyone has questions, I can answer them. Yeah, you should definitely get on that. And if you want to put yourself a particularly interesting, potentially lucrative challenge, you should think of publishing a Unity asset on the asset store. The language they use is C#. It's a very nice language. I don't know if you guys have used that, but it's pretty cool. Yeah, that's my day job. Again, I don't really do the 3D stuff. We're doing it. I basically prototype using Unity. It's actually super fun. I really love it. But yeah, any other questions? Yes.
Would you be able to like comment into like doing animations within Unity as well, because they do great art, but animations is lacking because they only work with humanoid figures.
Yes. When you say it's lacking, we do not provide animations.
Yeah, but like there's none.
So the animations are absent. Yeah. So we rely on users to acquire animations elsewhere. Are we thinking of providing animations packaged in with our asset packs?
Yeah.
I don't think so at this point in time. It's really a case-by-case basis. For example, we released a dog pack, if you've seen that. It's like a bunch of dogs and animals and hounds and stuff, and we did fully animate those. But that was, you know, they're not really humanoid. I think we rely on people to go to mixamo.com and find their own humanoid animations for that. Because it's kind of an area that has a pretty decent solution, we're not really solving a problem by providing animations necessarily. Whereas the absence of cheap and consistently styled low polygon assets, that's there's a gap there, and that's what the Synty is solving that. Yeah, kind of like a business angle. But yeah. So you use Synty stuff?
Yeah.
Awesome.
A lot of this stuff, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, me too, before I joined it.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of it, actually. Yeah.
I also have another question.
Yeah,
how was it like, because obviously you studied and you graduated and you got your first industry job / programming job. How was the kind of jump between university and your first real industry job?
Oh, great question. Yeah, so as I was saying before, I had this like nihilistic perspective thinking you can't really just get a games job. Honestly, I was very lucky because a friend of mine worked in the car park where the CEO of this company I worked at. Honestly, like I said, it's all about connections. So, and that was a guy who wasn't even connected, like, in the industry. He worked for the car park. And he's like, oh, I'm friends with the CEO. And I'm like, yeah, right. But he was, and he got me an interview. And also, so the gap, as you said, in the twilight of my third year studying computer science, I was so eager to start making a game, and I wanted to make, like, a story game. I made a visual novel using something called X&A. I don't know if anyone's known, but basically it uses C-sharp, and I made this visual novel, and it was terrible, but it was very personal, and I told the story that I wanted to tell, and it was relatively sophisticated in terms of the code. So I submitted that in my job interview, and they liked it. They thought, like, it's, you know, it was good. I was surprised too, and so I got hired. So like I said, yeah, you definitely want to build like some kind of portfolio. I know people say, oh, I have no work experience, I'm a grad. Like, you know, they want people with experience. You need to make your own experience. I mean, you need to show them that like you really want to make games. So how can you show them that better than making games? I really want to make games. Look, this is what I've made. There you go. So do that. And it's easier than ever to make games. I'm a Unity expert, I should say. If anyone has questions on Unity, I can also answer that. Did you have
Did you have any limitations when you were working with Unity?
Any limitations? There's plenty of limitations, but the thing about Unity that's great is it's very extendable. And it's why I love working with it. Like, everything that may not be there, you can just write yourself. So I would say there are no meaningful limitations. The limitations that are there, like, you just code a solution and it works.
Yeah. Just so I do have one final question, which is, how does it feel like going from independent to working for a company? I was kind of curious.
Oh yeah, I really skimmed past my like work history, but yeah, I was actually and still am an independent game developer. I do have a published game on Steam. Could you go to Steam and type Satori, S-A-T-O-R-I. So I made this game. It's a meditative parkour platform.
I see.
Yeah.
I was inspired by Mirror's Edge and Titanfall 2 and Lucio from Overwatch.
Yeah.
But the thing is, those games are very high stress, and for me, what I love about those games is that when you get like a runner's streak, you genuinely feel like this meditation. But if you fall and die, you have to like go through a loading screen and start over, and then you start like at 0 miles per hour, and it breaks your flow, literally. So this game I have here is a procedurally generated map. Anyway, blah, blah, blah. I'm an independent game developer. What is it like to go back to employment?
Yeah.
Well, indie games was always like a side hobby for me. I never had this entrepreneurial kind of take on it where I wanted to do this full time and have a company and hire people and stuff. I've always just wanted to keep it personal. In the same way that that first game I made to get my job, it was a very personal legal novel, very personal story. It was never really to sell, it was just like kind of for my own fulfillment. So it never really felt like a step down to go back to full-time employment. And and if you typed on Beauty and the Beast in Steam, so I'm actually making a new game based on Beauty and the Beast, which is an open license. It would be that first one. Yeah, so this is like the current game that I'm making. It's a first-person narrative adventure. So yeah, even though I'm employed, I still live my best life. You know, I still make what I want to do. I get creative fulfillment, and who knows? Maybe I could work and collaborate with people. I am in a position now where I can like comfortably say that. So who knows? Like maybe you could see like clap or a job at Emotion Theory. Yeah, was that all we had time for?
I actually have one last question.
Okay,
sorry. So as you know, in the game development industry worldwide, not just New Zealand, but there has been a lot of controversy about the work conditions in game development and what developers kind of go through to retain their spot in the industry. What is your take on the industry and how it's treated you, I guess?
Amazing question. How it's treated me? I have been very fortunate. The first job I got, very luxurious. I went from a junior programmer to like a creative director very quickly. That doesn't really happen, but as I said, my experience was very good. I did get fired from a job after that, so like, you know, what goes up must come down. That's another story, maybe I'll share with you guys later. But aside from that, I would say my experience has been very good. Synty is a very successful company, so and I have a very creative position in that too, so my experience has been very good. The industry in New Zealand, I would say as a whole though, and I'll get to worldwide in a sec, but in New Zealand, it's relatively junior. Even now, 10 plus years after I started, it was very junior back then, but it's still relatively junior today. You have companies like your big AAAs overseas. New Zealand struggles to get to that level. And I think only very few studios are actually competing at that level. You might think, for example, Rockerworks, which is right here in Auckland, they're probably one of the biggest studios here. But even they operate like with delays and like, their games launched that are super buggy and all this kind of stuff. Like they're still figuring things out. You know, there's not like a wealth of expertise, unfortunately. Even like Weta, which is like freaking Weta for God's sake. Even their games division feels like relatively junior. So the industry out there as a whole. Sorry. So I was treated very well in terms of work conditions. New Zealand work conditions, I think, as a whole, tends to be good. So even though we're relatively junior, we're at least conscientious and mindful of our employees here, for the most part. Again, it really varies from studio to studio. We do hear some nightmare stories from some studios. I will not name them, but we do hear them. If anybody's applying for jobs and you're concerned, just like maybe ask me and I'll tell you if it's sus or safe. Sus or safe. But yeah, the industry as a whole, worldwide, I think, in this kind of like post-liberal world that we live in now, I think it's very unsafe for them not to have an impeccable track record. And the industry as a whole has changed. We see now more accessibility options in games. We see now like more diversity in games, more representation, and the work conditions have improved as well. So yeah, we are improving. And credit needs to be given that, like, I think there's a lot more to go. And there's certainly like no shortage of things we can complain about, but we have improved and it's looking pretty good. Yeah.
I think that's about it. Okay.
All right.
Awesome.
So we're
going to
go to Q&A.
Synty Studios. Thank you for coming by.
Ah, thank you. Cheers.
Right, so here's a link to our link sheet. You guys have probably already seen what's on there. There's all our socials and sign up forms, things like that.
Who put that there?
I didn't come
in. Okay, moving on. That is the end of the slides, apparently. Oh, wonderful. Yeah, I'm definitely missing something. Yes, tutorials. I didn't actually elaborate on that a little bit. A lot, sorry. So next week starting, you will have tutorials. They'll be at the same time. It'll be in this room and the opposite room. Eddie takes that ones, I take the coding ones. So, well, from my perspective anyway, if you like know nothing about programming, if you're really junior to it, please come along. I'll try my best. I don't buy it, really. So that'll be next week. Everything will be in our Discord server. And if you are hungry, I implore you to leave this room.
Yes. That's your sushi.
Yes.
Yep. We've got sushi set up outside. Did you also mention the game jams that we do?
I knew I was forgetting something.
Game jams.
Right, yeah, game jams, right. So this is week two. This is week two. From week four, I think, yes, we'll be starting game jams. I think I mentioned this a couple days ago. And hopefully you are all up to the challenge.
That's all we have to tutorials.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I... Yeah.
No, we'll help you through them.
Hey, for job searching, by the way, your game jam entries can actually be portfolio pieces for your jobs. You should do it. It's also fun and networking. It's just win-win-win.
Yes. I think that covers everything. I guess I have another brain fart.
Nope.